Hello subscribers, welcome once again to Conquest TV. I'm Frankie and we're back to help you get the most from your Warhammer 40,000 Conquest subscription. In this instalment, we're going to cover the awesome content from the latest delivery, issues 7, 8, 9 and 10. There's a cool mix of models in these issues, with more Poxwalkers to reinforce your Death Guard horde, a deadly psychic warrior for the Ultramarines, and your first ever vehicle for Warhammer 40,000, the Myphitic Blight-hauler. There are also some new paints, which are very special indeed. Nuln Oil and Agrax Earthshade are Citadel Shades, paints that help you get amazing results on your models really easily. Now there's a lot to cover, so let's get right into it with a look at the amazing background you'll find in these issues. Issues 7 to 10 delve even further into the grim darkness of the far future than ever before, with some impressive feature articles. The making of a Space Marine is an in-depth view into what it takes to create a Space Marine. We look at the incredible technology that makes the galaxy's deadliest warriors, including the 22 organs implanted into the Primaris Space Marines. Space Marines have 2 hearts, 3 lungs, and a carapace that makes their ribs tough enough to stop a bullet. That's not all though. We also look at the impressive realm of Ultramar. Once these 500 worlds were ruled in relative peace by the Ultramarines and their mighty Primarch Rabute Gulliman. Now, 10,000 years later, the domain is besieged by enemies. The Ultramarines and their successor chapters fight constantly to protect Ultramar from invasion. Successor chapters? Yes, that's right, there are many powerful Space Marine chapters, and some of the greatest share the same heritage as the Ultramarines. You'll learn more about the Silver Skulls, Sides of the Emperor, and more. We're also going to learn about the role of the Librarians within the Space Marine chapters. These warrior scholars maintain the ancient records of the chapter. Every proud victory, every terrible defeat is preserved for the future. These aren't stuffy bookkeepers though. Space Marine Librarians are the psychic defenders of the chapter. Deadly warriors who can unleash devastating powers on the battlefield. Armed with force weapons, they banish demons and cast down humanity's foes. Issue 9 draws us back into the hideous history of the Poxwalkers, with a detailed breakdown on these grotesque plague zombies. It also takes a look at the fall of Spiros, where a once proud hive city found itself completely overrun by Poxwalkers. It's a cautionary tale too. You can't hide from Nurgle's plagues. And finally, we're introduced to the Myphitic Blight-haulers. These war engines are part machine, part demonic creature, and all bad intentions as they advance on the enemy, guns blazing, their gnashing maws capable of shredding metal and crushing bones, even Space Marine bones. They've been instrumental in winning countless battles for the Death Guard, including the raid on Relthor Prime. In issues 7 to 10, we got a few new models in our collection. Poxwalkers, the Primaris Librarian, and the Myphitic Blight-hauler. Because the Librarian and the Blight-hauler are the most complex builds we've attempted so far, we'll be focusing on those here. If you want a reminder on how to assemble these hideous creations, there's a full guide in issue 8 and some tips back in video 2. Right then, let's get started with the Librarian. The Librarian comes supplied, like all our models, on plastic frames, but there's a lot to take in here. He's so impressive, he comes on 2. And as you can probably guess, we're going to need to use some plastic glue to assemble him. To build this model, just follow the steps as laid out in your issue. Before you get started though, I've got a couple of pointers. First up, when you're assembling him, it's important to build the Librarian's body in the right order, especially when it comes to his robes. You'll see that part 5 is a small segment of cloth. This slots into part 6, but you have to do it from the inside. Secondly, we have an important choice to make. The Librarian model comes with 2 heads, one with a helmet and one with a bear head. It doesn't matter which one you build for your game, so just pick the one you like. I'm going for the bear head. It'll be cool to paint that face later on. So cut off part 16 and use glue to attach it into the gap beneath his psychic hood. The Blight-hauler is the biggest model we've attempted together so far, but it's not that complicated. In fact, it's much easier than the Librarian. You don't even need glue to build the Blight-hauler either. You can use your plastic glue to join the parts even more securely together, but that's up to you. As with our other kits, each part is numbered on the frame. Let's start with parts 1 and 2. Part 1 is this massive fleshy engine part, while part 2 is this set of tracks. fit them together like so. Part 3 is the other side of the armoured engine, and it pushes in on the other side of the tracks. Give it a good squeeze to make sure you're happy with the fit. The next bit is Part 4, this weird set of demonic mandibles. This goes underneath and pushes on here. When it's on, it should look like this. Now we need to add the outer tracks. These each come in 2 pieces, 5 and 6, which go together like so. Then parts 7 and 8, which are basically the same. They push into the bottom of the mandible section, just like this. The Blight-hauler needs some serious firepower, so let's build the armored carapace, multi-melter, and missile launcher. The multi-melter is parts 9 and 10. They push together like this. While the missile launcher is part 11. Push this into the slot on part 12, just like this, and then fix the multi-melter into place like so. That is a lot of firepower right there. Fix this whole carapace onto the main body by pushing it onto this peg here. Take a moment to line it up carefully and then squeeze it into position. Finally, add the main hull armor, part 13. It pushes on right here and completes your Myphitic Blight-hauler. You can push the finished model onto the base like so, but it's actually a good idea to leave it off until you've painted it. That way, you can get at the underside more easily. So in this instalment, we've got some really fun painting opportunities. The new Citadel shades, Nuln Oil and Agrax Earthshade are going to make our models look awesome. And we've got the super detailed Librarian, Blight-hauler and more Poxwalkers to enjoy. Let's start out by showing you how Citadel shades work. Our models have loads of details on them, and while our paint jobs look really good so far, shades help us take it to another level. Shades are formulated to flow over the details of a model and give amazing depth and rich tones to our miniatures. Take a look at this before and after of this Plague Marine. This one has been painted with base paints and looks good, but check out the difference with this one. The gold looks richer with deep recesses, and the metal on his chainmail and knife looks awesome. Painting shades onto your models is nice and simple too. In fact, most veteran hobbyists absolutely love using them. All you need to do is to give your pot of paint a quick shake, making sure that the lid is firmly on whilst you're doing this, and then open it up and there should be a little bit of paint settled in the lip that is just beneath the lid there. So what I'm going to do is get some of that shade onto my bristles. Then I'll pick up my Plague Marine and paint the shade over this metal part here, over the Retributor armor. It looks really, really good over this gold color. Now, once you've done this, don't forget to leave plenty of time for the paint to dry before you move on to the next stage. Nuln Oil is a dark, almost black shade that works great on surfaces such as silver metal. Basically, everything we've painted with Lead Belcher. So let's paint it onto our existing models. Take an intercessor and collect some Nuln Oil in the bristles, like so. Then just paint it on, like this. Now don't put too much on at once, we don't want to drown out the detail. Paint it on and move it around with your bristles. You can paint it onto all of the silver areas on your models, the Reavers, Plague Marines and Poxwalkers, even Lieutenant Calcius. Even though Nuln Oil is runnier than normal paint, you still need to wash your brush when you're done with it. Regularly stop and wash your brush out in clean water as you did with your other paints. Agrax Earthshade is a brown shade designed to bring out the best in areas of models that look good with brown shadows, like the gold on our Space Marines and Death Guard. Use it on the shoulder trim and chest eagles, sword hilts and other important areas of your Space Marine intercessors. Do this for your other Ultramarines too. But make sure you don't overload your brush as you paint. The Death Guard have their own gold details to pick out as well. Spikes, shoulder guards, armor trim, and more. The Poxwalkers even have some gold of their own. Not much though, because it's a hard life being a plague-cursed slave. Now once you've applied Nuln Oil and Agrax Earthshade to all of your models, the finished results will look gorgeous. Check out these examples here. The Space Marine Librarian is a very detailed model, but don't be intimidated. He's basically the same as every other Space Marine you've painted so far. In fact, if you've done Lieutenant Calcius, you can definitely do the Librarian too. Just follow the guide in your magazine and you'll soon have your Warrior Scholar looking awesome. I do have a couple of tips for you to consider though, as you paint. Firstly, the swirling patterns on the foresword of the Librarian. Now, I would recommend you paint the blade in Lead Belcher first and allow that to dry before painting the Retributor armour in the patterns on the sword. Now, take your time painting this pattern so that you definitely get the best result. You'll also notice these cables underneath the Librarian's arm. Now, you can see that the smaller ones are painted in Abaddon Black and the thicker cables are painted in Lead Belcher. Now, you need to be really, really careful with these, so try and get a really fine point on your brush. If you do make any mistakes, you can always touch it up with Macragge Blue on the armour or on the cape. This model is the biggest one we've painted so far, and we're going to need plenty of Death Guard Green to start off with. It's a good idea to mix a little water into your paint on a palette for this. Just take some paint from the pot and add it to your palette with a drop of water from your bristles. This way, you can do a couple of thin coats rather than a thick one that might obscure your details. With your paint ready, you can now apply Death Guard Green all over your miniature. So I'm going to take some onto my brush here and cover it in a thin coat of Death Guard Green. And once this dries, I can apply a second thin coat. Once you've applied your Death Guard Green and it's all dried, your Blight-hauler should look like this. Now the Blight-hauler is a really strange beast, part machine, part flesh, part demon. So let's paint all those gross fleshy bits with Bugman's Glow. As before, wet your brush before painting the Bugman's Glow on and just take your time painting all of the fleshy areas. Pick up the model and move it around if that helps to get the brush into the hard to reach areas. Now start with the larger areas first, then move on to the smaller ones. Around the central eye and the fanged maw, you'll need to be especially careful. Once all the gross fleshy bits are painted, it's time to move on to all of that demonic metal, which means you'll need plenty of Lead Belcher. Use this to paint the tracks, machinery, and even the metal fangs at the front of the Blight-hauler. Now, take lots of care when painting the smaller areas. Washing your brush regularly and keeping a fine point on your bristles will help you be more accurate. Now that you're done with all the metal parts, it's time for Abaddon Black. Paint it onto the stinger on the rear of the Blight-hauler and the non-metal teeth at the front. Now that we've done all the black parts, it's time to add a base coat of Retributor armour, which will really, really help our model to look great. Now start out with the armour trim and the Nurgle icon at the centre of its carapace, but also get the spiked rail that runs along the spine and the heat shield on the multi-melter. With the base coats added, all we need to do now to finish our Blight-hauler is to apply those shades. Start with Nuln Oil and get all of those silver parts. Give the pot a good shake and paint it straight on with your brush. Now remember, don't apply it so heavily that it obscures the details of your model. A good trick is to start at the front of the model and work clockwise around it, painting all the Lead Belcher parts as you go. And finally, Agrax Earthshade. Pick out all those awesome gold details such as the armor banding and spike rail. Paint on enough so that some settles in the recesses, but try not to overload it. With the Agrax Earthshade painted on, our Blight-hauler is completed and ready for battle. In the future, we'll come back to add even more details and colours to this model. For now though, we've got a great looking miniature, so onto the gaming. So with our models built and painted, let's get down to some playing. Our first game adds some new rules for falling back. There are going to be times when even the bravest warriors need to withdraw from combat and regroup. You'll find all of this in issue 7. To learn these rules, let's set up a simple battle. Get out your game mat and ready your warriors. For the Ultramarines, we'll need the Primaris Reavers and Lieutenant Calcius, while the Death Guard have 3 Plague Marines and a unit of Poxwalkers. Don't forget to use the special rules for your models. You can remind yourself of them by checking the data sheets in issue 7. Up till now, if a unit in your force is caught in a fight, they've had to slug it out until they win or were defeated. With the rules for falling back, you now have an extra choice. If you don't think they can win, your unit can fall back. To do this, your unit must be locked in combat, so have an enemy unit within 1 inch. To fall back, just move your unit up to their full move away from the enemy so that they end up more than 1 inch from any enemy models. This is great for getting out of a fight you can't win. Here's the downside though. A unit that does decide to fall back cannot advance, charge, or shoot later that turn. So only do this if it's best for your warriors. There are a few restrictions on falling back too. When you fall back, your models can't move within 1 inch of a new enemy. They also can't move through any enemies. So, if your warriors are completely surrounded, there's no way for them to get out and they're gonna have to fight instead. The best way to use this ability is to have a unit that's in trouble fall back so that another unit can get involved instead. Right, let's give this a try in a full game. We'll be using the mission in issue 7, Secure the Gene Seed. A chapter's reserve of Gene Seed is essential to its survival. And aboard the Honor of Ultramar, the Death Guard are attempting to seize a valuable crate filled with this precious cargo. Place an objective marker in the center of the board to represent the Gene Seed, like so. Next, deploy your forces like we did before. Roll off to see who deploys the first unit, with the winner placing one of his units on the deployment markers as normal. The player who deploys second can take the first turn. Now, to win the battle, all you have to do is to get the Gene Seed crate back to one of your deployment markers. Do that, and you are victorious. Any model can pick up and move the objective marker by moving into base contact with it. Pick up the marker and place it underneath your model. Wherever the model moves, the objective marker goes too. If that model dies though, it will leave the objective behind, and another model will have to move onto it and pick it up instead. Now, give the mission a go and see who is victorious. Once you've played the game through, you might like to add some extra rules. You'll find these in the replay section. While the Death Guard will get even deadlier weapon rules, the Space Marines get Codex Discipline. This means that Ultramarines who fall back can still shoot. Perfect for gunning down a horde of onrushing Poxwalkers. With falling back mastered, it's on to our next gaming tutorial, where we'll introduce the psychic phase. Some rare warriors in Warhammer 40,000 are able to channel incredible powers to aid their allies or obliterate their foes. These are psykers. As you learn the rules for psykers, it's a good idea to play through a battle. Set up a game as described in issue 8. You'll need your game mat, the Primaris Librarian, and a unit of 5 Plague Marines. This is a fight to the death. The first player to wipe out all the enemy's models is the winner. With our models ready, the first thing we need to do is to introduce the psychic phase. Yes, that's right, psychic powers are so important that they get their own phase. The psychic phase happens right after the move phase. For now, only the Ultramarines will get to use this phase, as your Death Guard don't have any psychers yet, and only the Librarian can use psychic powers. To use a psychic power, follow this sequence. Choose your psyker and power. Make a psychic test. Resolve the psychic power. Let's go through these together. First, choose your psyker and the power you want to use. Now, this is easy. It will be our Librarian, and he only has one psychic power in this battle, which is Smite. Smite is a dangerous power that can target any visible enemy unit within 18 inches of the Librarian. Next, make a psychic test. Every psychic power has a warp charge value. Roll 2 dice and add the score together. If the score equals or beats the warp charge value of your chosen power, it's successful. If the roll is lower, the power fails to manifest. But wait, psychic powers really are deadly. To use them, a psyker has to tear open the fabric of reality, and lots can go wrong when you do something like that. If you ever roll a double 1 or a double 6 when making a psychic test, demons from the warp tear into your psyker's mind and he suffers D3 mortal wounds. This is known as Perils of the Warp. Now, there were a couple of rules in there that could do with a little explaining. A D3 is a special dice roll. Roll a dice as normal, but half the number and round up. Mortal wounds are so devastating that no wound roll is required and they cannot be stopped by armor. When a model takes a mortal wound, immediately reduce their wounds total by the number unless they have the disgustingly resilient rule. This still applies. Now, if Perils of the Warp kills the Librarian, his power ends immediately. Still with me? Good. So what if the psychic test is successful? Well, then the smite power works and the target takes D3 mortal wounds instead. And that's a great way to wipe out some Plague Marines. Okay, let's put all of that into practice with the Clear the Deck mission. The battle for the cargo deck rages on, and the Ultramarines have been reinforced by Librarian Arion. Recognizing a deadly foe when they see one, the Death Guard must kill him if they want to seize control of the ship. Now, the Death Guard win if they can kill Librarian Arion. The Ultramarines win if they can wipe out all of the Death Guard. For this battle, increase the number of models on the board. The Death Guard get 2 units of 3 Plague Marines and a unit of 6 Poxwalkers. The Ultramarines get Librarian Arion and 3 Reavers. Remember when you play that Smite still needs line of sight, so the Death Guard can try and take cover if they want to avoid annihilation. Also, remember that Librarian Arion is a character, so he can only be targeted if he's the closest visible enemy model. Once you've played through this mission, you'll want to try it with some additional rules. In the replay section, you'll find a second psychic power for your Librarian to unleash in battle, and rules for the Plague Marines Blight Launcher, which is great at busting open the Ultramarines armor. For our next game, we're going to look at how to use even larger units. We have 12 Poxwalkers in our collection, and that can add a couple of complications to our game. Let's set up a battle to work our way through this. Get out your playmat and set it up. You'll also need Lieutenant Calcius and all 12 of your Poxwalkers. Both players should roll a dice, and the winner places their unit first. Pick any of the deployment markers as usual. Now in this game, the Death Guard player will go first. The first rule we're going to look at is how to move large units. 12 Poxwalkers is quite a big unit, and moving them can take a while. There is a way to speed this up though. Before moving your models, take a good look at their position within the squad. Then move the models up the front first, measuring carefully. Once those have moved, you can move the models behind them, keeping the same position and distance from the models in front. Doing this can really speed up your play. Just be careful that you don't accidentally take any extra movement on your models as you move. Just as moving with large units can slow your game down, so can attacking with them. There are 2 things we can do to help with this. First, in close combat, a model can always attack so long as it is within 1 inch of a friendly model who is within 1 inch of an enemy. Imagine them lunging in to attack the same foe as their ally. Secondly, it can help to roll in batches. What this means is count up the number of attacks you'll need to make from all the models in a unit with the same kind of attack. Then roll them all together, remembering how many hits you get before you make your wound rolls. Got all that? Let's try it out in the mission, Overwhelmed. As the battle rages across the Honor of Ultramar, the number of crew who have fallen to the plague that walks increases. Lieutenant Calcius has encountered a band of Poxwalkers blocking his path to his allies. Set up the battlefield as we described earlier. You'll have Lieutenant Calcius against 12 Poxwalkers, and the game lasts for 5 battle rounds. The Ultramarines win if Calcius can move onto the deployment marker highlighted in red here. The Death Guard win by stopping Calcius from reaching his goal, either by killing him or just delaying him for the full 5 battle rounds. Now remember to take a look at the data sheets for your units and refer back to them as you play. Once you've played the battle through, check out the extra rules to add to all of your games. There are rules for using grenades in battle and a special bonus for units of Poxwalkers with 10 or more models. Our last game for this video introduces the Blight-hauler. It is going to be a brutal battle. The battle for Honor of Ultramar isn't over yet. As the Ultramarines gather their warriors in the depths of the cargo hold, explosions rack the makeshift battlefield. A Myphitic Blight-hauler has arrived to smash apart the Space Marine lines. Let's get our game set up. We'll need our mat, as well as your Librarian, 3 Intercessors, and your new Myphitic Blight-hauler. Roll to see who places their models first. Vehicles in Warhammer 40,000 work much like any other models. Take a look at the Blight-hauler's datasheet and you'll see it's basically the same as the other models in your collection so far. The first difference is that it can move much faster. In fact, it can move 10 inches. The second major difference is that it can fire each of its weapons. Choose which weapon will fire at which targets before making any rolls though. The Blight-hauler's guns are probably the deadliest weapons we've seen in the game so far. The multi-melter will wound our Space Marines on a roll of 2 or more. It's so powerful that Space Marines don't actually get an armor save at all. Worse still, any model wounded by the multi-melter will suffer D6 wounds. Roll a dice and the model suffers that much damage. Any wounds beyond the number needed to kill the target are just wasted, and we imagine these just make the victim's death even messier. The Blight-hauler's frag missile launcher is another unusual weapon. Before rolling to hit, roll a D6. The score is the number of shots you get. Now once you have the number of shots worked out, you make the to-hit rolls as a batch. The Blight-hauler can also charge and fight in close combat as normal. In fact, it is deadly up close. Something to bear in mind is Librarian Arion's Force Sword. Until now, we've not needed all of its special rules. But each unsaved wound caused by the four sword does D3 wounds. Just like before, to work out how many wounds this is, roll a dice and half the score, rounding up. The Blight-hauler will need to get a 6 plus armor save against the Force Sword. If this is failed, it will also get to make a disgustingly resilient save for each damage point it suffers. There are some very powerful models to play in this mission, so make sure you have the data sheets for your units on hand as you play your game. Once you're ready, it's time to fight out our last battle in this video. Smite the Blight-hauler. Determined to break the deadlock and smash through to the interior of the Honor of Ultramar, the Death Guard have unleashed a Myphitic Blight-hauler. Only a Primaris Librarian and a squad of three Reavers stand in its path. Set up the game mat as before. The Death Guard player gets the first turn. The Death Guard player wins the battle if the Blight-hauler can eliminate the Primaris Librarian. Now the Ultramarines win if they can slay the Blight-hauler. With such great armor and so many wounds, the Blight-hauler is going to take some serious killing. The Librarian is the Ultramarine's best chance for victory, but if you risk him in battle, you might end up losing the game completely. But don't forget, there's no shame in taking cover. The Multi-Melter is so powerful that a single shot could kill even the Librarian. Once you've given this battle a go or two, make sure you check out the extra rules at the back of issue 10. The Blight-hauler has one more powerful ability we haven't even looked at yet, the Bile Spurt. Yes, that's right, this monstrous demon engine has another weapon. The Ultramarines are going to need every advantage they can get to stop it. Well, that's everything for this installment of Conquest TV. Thanks for joining us. Next time, we'll be building and assembling even more fantastic miniatures with reinforcements for the Ultramarines in the form of deadly Primaris aggressors. The Death Guard are going to be bolstered too with their first character, the repugnant Foul Blightspawn. There's also a new paint, a new type of paintbrush, and most exciting of all, our first terrain pieces, which will transform the look and feel of our battlefield. All this alongside enthralling new background and stories, painting tips, and gaming advice to get your models waging war on the battlefield. Oh, and don't forget to subscribe. When you do, you can upgrade to a premium subscription for an enhanced gameplay experience. You'll get 4 boxes of premium accessories, including unique fold-out gaming boards made of hard-wearing card, exclusive Conquest dice, gaming tokens, and handy reference cards for your models as well. Check out the Conquest website for more details. Until next time, I'm Frankie, and we'll see you soon.